It's finally open, Denver's first family justice center, the Rose Andom Center, is open for business. Denver Police Lieutenant Adam Hernandez and Deputy DA Allison Rocker join Denver DA Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. I'm Tamara Banks. Welcome back to this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, great to be with you again.
Great to be with you,
Tamara. And I'm so glad to have our guests here today, Allison Rocker and Adam Hernandez. It's been a long time since I've seen you.
It has been.
Good to see you again. Thank you. So if I know, Mitch, this has been such a project that's so near and dear to your heart. Can you sort of paint a picture of what the center does and what its purpose is?
Well, about 10 years ago, we started really pursuing getting a family justice center in Denver. There is not one in the Rocky Mountain region, or at least there wasn't then, there is now. And we knew they were springing up around the country. At the time, we went for a big grant and didn't get it. When we lost that grant, we had the partnerships built. This is about partnerships and collaboration. But we needed the center, we needed the place to have it happen. And so we've worked really hard to do that. We brought in more partners. We've reached out to the community and raised, I think now it's close to $13 million, including the building. We got the building, we've redone the building. The Rose Andom Center is on the third floor of the building. We have a way to pay to keep the Rose Andom Center operational, and the city's a great partner in it, along with the Denver Police and so many of the other nonprofit partners. And the great part of it was when we did the ribbon cutting in June, it was a nice event, but everybody went to work. After the event was over, they went to work. These teams started to have an impact that afternoon. And it's continuing, and we're seeing an increase in felony filings. We're seeing an awful lot of good work happening in the law enforcement side of the Rose Andom Center.
So these are, it was focused on helping victims of domestic violence.
Right.
So what was new today? What's new today that wasn't available before?
There's a place to go for someone that's the victim of domestic violence. Mm-hmm. Maybe they didn't bother contacting the police. Maybe they've been waiting or questioning, should I get involved in the police? Where can I get help? This is a place where someone can walk in the door and reach all the different agencies, all the different nonprofits that can help them. They don't want to talk to the police or people from my office. They don't have to. But they can start to get that help that they need to get out of this vicious system, this vicious cycle that they're stuck in, which is domestic violence. And when you say stuck, you think one person that gets battered. That's not what this is about. These are families. These are entire generations of people that are exposed to this horrible crime. And then you start to see it again and again and again. So our hope is that it will have a long-term impact. Those kids that are exposed to it will no longer be exposed to it. They will have people that will help them. There are our partners. We've had them on this show a number of times. The different agencies that our viewers have looked at for years around helping kids and people with mental illness and domestic violence, Project PAVE, all of those kinds of programs, they're there to help everybody that have been touched by domestic violence.
And Allison and Adam, as the DA said, many people went right to work right after the ribbon cutting, and I bet you were two of the many people who did that and rolled up your sleeves and went to work. What do each of you do there specifically? Maybe Adam, I'll start with you as a police investigator and how you operate within that system in that center.
Sure. So the Denver Police Department's Domestic Violence Unit has for almost ever been headquartered at our police headquarters. We moved the entire unit over to the Rose Andom Center. So we have 11 detectives and two sergeants and me who are staffing the Rose Andom Center's Domestic Violence Unit for the police department. And so it makes it really nice because, as Mitch said, you don't have to report to the police department to get services from them, but we are immediately available in the event anybody walks in and wants to report a domestic violence. It makes it convenient. You know, if you have a victim who lives someplace outside of the Denver area but works downtown and doesn't want police in their home because for whatever reasons they're afraid, the husband, the boyfriend, whoever he might be, the abuser, she's afraid that the police come in and they want a report, she can walk into the Rose Andom Center and do it. Now that doesn't take away the fact that you can do it in any police station or still at headquarters. We'll go and meet them, but we hope it's more convenient for the victim to come in. So we are immediately available to them. And it's working really well with the district attorney. We have seen some very nice results. You know, Mitch has clearly demonstrated a lot of tremendous commitment to this and to this collaboration issue. And he has signed, or by assigning Allison, a full-time attorney for the people, if you will, to the Rose Andom Center, the collaboration has just been unbelievable. And really what we're looking for in our investigations in the long term are better investigations, better prosecution, more conviction, if you will, too. So it just kind of works out nicely.
So Allison, talk a little bit about that, your role and how you're working with the police department.
Sure. My role has several pie pieces, and the largest pie piece is working with the Denver Police Department. So I file any state domestic violence case, whether it be misdemeanor or felony. I look at what charges should be filed, what are appropriate. Is there more investigation that can be done, and can I help detectives with that? And since we're 30 yards away from each other, it's a really easy collaboration. And as Mitch and Adam have said, we've seen results already. We're seeing being able to file misdemeanors up to the clarified DV habitual laws, felonies. Other parts of my role, there are community outreach. So I'm working with the Denver Police Department to do trainings at low-income housing to talk about the financial consequences of domestic violence, or reaching underserved communities to urge them to report domestic violence, even if they fear the consequences, say if they are in the country undocumented. The third pie piece there is to help our younger deputies effectively prosecute domestic violence. And I would say one of the most recent benefits we've seen of this collaboration, and then someone that's not here today, the city attorney is also right with us in this law enforcement side. And so what we've seen is a detective will come and present to me a simple misdemeanor assault, which would just be a third degree class one misdemeanor. But this abuser has been abusing for years and years and years. And all of those years and years and years of violations are city tickets, something that I wouldn't normally have readable access to if I was at the web building in our office. But because the city attorney is 5 feet from me, they can look up those convictions, I can use them and file that simple misdemeanor as a felony, as a habitual domestic violence offender. And so we've really been able to collaborate to hold these offenders accountable through more effective investigation and prosecution.
So actually being there just a few feet away in the same office really makes a big difference.
And Tamara, huge. The reason it's important is this, and I can tell you, I remember when the Denver police didn't have a domestic violence unit. I mean, I go back long enough to remember when it was, if somebody didn't go to the hospital, nobody got arrested. You got sent to walk around the, you know, go take a walk, cool off, that kind of thing, early 80s. And what you would see then when you would prosecute these domestic violence murders, maybe 7 felonies that were committed against this woman, number of assaults, those kinds of things, that were never prosecuted, he was never held accountable for. And our system holds people accountable when they pick up felonies. We have habitual domestic violence, habitual burglaries, habitual criminals. And so when you have an habitual criminal that never even gets charged with a felony, you know, it's important that we can hold these guys accountable, get them very lengthy sentences before they commit the murder. And that's really what, for me, was so startling, was that this area, when you'd look, and it was a woman, and she'd put up with this for years. This woman had been divorced from this guy for 11 years, and he'd committed at least seven felonies against her, never charged. But had we started that process of charging him, having him go to the penitentiary, having him get out, maybe continuing, by the third time, we could have put him away for life. Mm-hmm. And that's why this is important, to hold these guys accountable for what they do to these victims, to make sure we charge them appropriately, and to make sure then that we follow up with those statutes that we have that are so important. And I got to give credit to the legislature this year, because they gave us two important tools to continue our work around domestic violence. They fixed a broken habitual criminal domestic violence statute that was so poorly written we couldn't use it, and we didn't use it. Now we're using it almost on a daily basis, and we will have success in court with it. The other thing is they recognized how dangerous strangling somebody is. No matter what the situation, if you grab somebody by the throat, you're sending a message to them. You know, that's what keeps them alive, being able to breathe, and their heart, and all the things that are connected there in the neck. You're sending a message to a victim of domestic violence when you grab them by the neck. And now, when you grab them by the neck, you're facing a felony charge. And I don't often compliment the legislature, but I have to do that on this occasion. They got it right. We went to them, we showed them why. There was a group of us again that went up there and said, we need this, other states have it, and they gave it to us. And we're going to see an increase there. So we're going to hold those guys, those men and women that are doing this to people they're supposed to love, in front of children that are watching it. We're going to hold them accountable, and the legislature has helped us with that.
And what we know about children is that they'll pattern what they're seeing their parents do.
Oftentimes,
and
yes.
Not to mention the trauma that is involved, even if the person isn't killed, if the victim isn't killed, they still have lots to deal with. We're going to take a quick break, and I want to talk more about this. We're going to talk about you mentioned prevention, too, and I think that's really interesting to talk about. We'll be right back with more with Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. Back in a moment.
Made of moments. Family. A drunk driver could take it all away. Keep your family safe on the road, because after all, nothing is more beautiful. Mothers Against Drunk Driving. Keep your family safe.
Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. This is the area of the show where we talk about a legal term. Today's legal term is dismissed without prejudice, and that is the judge's decision to end a case but permit the prosecutor to renew the case later. In contrast, dismissal with prejudice prevents a prosecutor from bringing the same action again. And we've heard a little bit about this. Tell us more.
You know, really, a judge can't dismiss a case. We dismiss cases. Mm-hmm. And so we do it in two ways. One, we dismiss with prejudice, or we dismiss without prejudice. Remember, we bring charges before the statute of limitations runs. So oftentimes we have years. Say in a sex assault, we may have 9 years that we could bring that case back. So if we bring a case, we get to a point where we feel we can't go forward because of elements not there or something, then we'll dismiss the case without prejudice. Which means we could bring that case back. Mm-hmm. And if something develops or the statute of limitations doesn't run and we bring the charges, we just go ahead and proceed with the charges if we can. Dismissing it with prejudice means we won't bring it back. We're done. This case is not going forward. It will never be charged again. But I think in the definition, you've got to be really clear. A judge cannot dismiss a case. What a judge can do to you is if you start a trial and you don't present enough evidence at the halftime, the judge can rule that you can't go forward. But technically, a judge can't legally dismiss a case without the DA saying, "Judge, I'm moving to dismiss the case."
I see. Okay. Good. All right. Well, back to the topic at hand, the Rose Andom Center for Domestic Violence Victims. Before we went to the break, Allison, you had brought up the issue of prevention, and that's also something that's available. Can both you and Adam talk about what they're available for, teaching maybe the victim and the perpetrator about how to prevent from being in a situation like domestic violence?
Sure. I think one of the things that Rose Andom does, and the ripple effect we're going to start seeing, is that with all of the community agencies there, with the rapid response that we are getting services to these victims, and the collaboration going on between the police department, the district attorney's office, and the city attorney's office, is that we're going to see victims who are staying engaged, who are staying cooperative, and working with us longer, because they are getting the resources they need to get out of that relationship, to get away from that abuser, while still being able to engage and cooperate within the criminal case. So I think that will help with prevention, because as you know, so many of these crimes go on for years and years and years before any report is made to law enforcement. So once we have that, we've effectively ended that abusive relationship. And hopefully what we've done is shown children in those relationships that their mother, their father, someone is strong enough to leave, and that abuse should not be in loving relationships. And hopefully we're ending cycles through these services as well, and through more effective investigations and prosecutions.
Right. Lieutenant Hernandez, can you talk a little bit about what's different for your police officers being part of the Rose Andom Center?
Well, the immediacy, the immediate availability, if you will, to the resources that are there at the Rose Andom Center. You know, it's nice. I mean, we talk about the proximity of the district attorney and the proximity of the city attorney. That is real. And what's happening is, as a consequence to that, is more efficiency on our part. So we're not having to walk across the street and look for a district attorney or a city attorney. They're right there. And I've got to commend Allison, because her availability is just there. She's in our portion of the sections where our detectives are frequently. She is very welcoming in her office to the detectives. So being able to just walk the 40 yards or 30 yards, whatever it is, to talk with Allison or the city attorney really makes for some incredible efficiencies. And it helps us be better responsive to our victims.
And if you think about it in terms of the victim, you know, the detective walks down and talks to my people. The victim then walks, when she's done talking to the police, the district attorney, she walks down and now Safe House Denver, where she's going to need shelter, her kids. So we're talking, you know, the Children's Advocacy Center. That's the same, as he describes for the detectives, is exactly the same for the victim. Here is the victim with everybody that she needs to talk to at one place before she goes out the door. And she may be going out the door to Safe House Denver, and which is one of our great partners. But that is really the idea there. It's that same convenience. We used to lose the victim. She'd walk out of police headquarters. Where was I supposed to go? Who was I supposed to talk to? Or go to that first place, that second place, maybe that fifth place. And by that time I was, well, this is just too hard. I'm going back. And then going back is getting beaten again, exposing your kids to this again, all of those kinds of things. So if the viewers think about it, you know, it's real convenient for everybody that works together on these cases, but that victim then can be handed to the person that's going to maybe make a difference in if she goes back or not. And then if she continues, like Allison said, to cooperate with us so we can hold the person accountable. But that's only a very small side of what this services that will be provided for those people. And eventually, the way this is set up with cooking classes, with ideas about training people, with our partners like Aero Electronics, who has moved to Colorado, that's looking for a workforce that's highly trained to do the kind of work they do around computers, those kind of things. They're looking to help us train these women and men and victims of domestic violence, survivors, to then go on and have the financial wherewithal to stay out of the relationship and not be dragged back in.
Right, that's really tempting to go back in where you know that at least the bills are going to be paid and you have a home. We've talked about partners, and not everybody is at the center yet. Who is there besides the police department and the DA's office? Who else are some of the partners involved?
Actually, quite a few now. The city agencies, of mm-hmm. course, the Victims Assistance Unit from DPD, the city attorneys, our office. And then on the services side, the nonprofit side, are quite a few. Project Safeguard, Safe House, Coalition for the Homeless, Dress to Success is coming in. Servicios is moving in. Colorado Legal Services is already present. I can't memorize them all. There's so many that are already there and already providing services to victims and their children. Denver Children's Advocacy Center is present and has an office there, as well as the amazing children's room that's present to make children feel comfortable when their parent has to come in for services.
I mean, it's literally one-stop shopping for a person.
And we put in the interview rooms that the police department mm-hmm. need. Very comfortable. There's not a camera sitting in their faces. They can sit down and interview and document then the statements, those kind of things. Really, I think the last piece, not because they don't want to be there, but we built a clinic there to do examinations, evaluations. We're hoping to get forensic nurses in there along the same lines of what we have with the SANE nurse program mm-hmm. over at Denver Health, although sometimes a rape examination is required, but oftentimes that's not. There's a cost to the Denver Police Department to have a rape examination done, to have a forensic examination done, but to be able to have that done right there around the corner in a clinic that we've built and put in the Rose Andom Center. That piece will probably, I think, be the last piece that kind of gets put in place. And we're working with Denver Health. They're great partners, but you know, they have certain rules around how many people they have to see, can they staff, that type of thing. They can't send someone over for one interview, for one examination. So how many days can they run the clinic, that kind of thing.
Has there been anything that's surprised you in this short time that the center's been open that you thought, wow, I didn't see that coming, good or bad? Success stories maybe you can even talk about at this point, at this short time?
Just how quickly we saw benefit. Mm-hmm. Just how quickly it was as effective as it can be. I think another example is I have been in touch with multiple senior district attorneys from other counties that are in charge of domestic violence prosecution who are coming down to meet with me, do tours of Rose Andom, talk about policy issues. And I think it's going to be kind of a center also for all of the district attorneys to get on the same page about how we're prosecuting these guys, what are our policy stands that we're taking, and hopefully that will also lead to better prosecution and investigation. So I think Rose Andom Center not only being the immediate resource for victims, but also really laying the groundwork for long-term benefit to the work we do with this type of crime.
And so if we do it right, like Allison, like we're talking about, there'll be more centers. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's the critical thing. You know, it was a shame that we had no centers in the Rocky Mountain region. Now we have the Rose Andom Center. Aurora's talking about one out in the 18th Judicial District. Wyoming, those types of places will come and see what we do, see how we do it, and then they will put together what will work in their communities. So this has laid the groundwork to really improve the way we do this in Denver. It was the missing piece in Denver, but if you think about it, it really is the missing piece throughout our part of the country, and this will have an impact throughout the entire Rocky Mountain region.
That's what I was going to ask you. If you have interests, say, as far away as Grand Junction or even beyond the state of Colorado and New Mexico, maybe police departments in other parts of this region have been reaching out to you, because really, I mean, there's nothing else like this around here. Is that's right?
And sometimes our victims are here that have been abused from all over. They'll walk into Denver system. But go ahead, and that was a question directed more to you.
You know, to be honest with you, I have not been contacted by any other law enforcement agency. But what I got to say is what has been so impressive about this is I think the system has been improved just by the fact that all of the services are immediately available. You know, it's like Mitch had mentioned, a victim can be walked from the police section or the district attorney section right across the hallway to where all of the private services are available. Before, they'd have to get on a bus or they'd have to drive their car across town and worry about parking or the transportation aspect of it. We were losing victims. And this Family Justice Center helps us maintain those victims, provide better services, or the same services, but immediately available, which makes it better. We're not losing them. And the idea really is we're here to improve the lives of victims of domestic violence, their families, and this is helping us do that.
Right. This is an example where the system really does work and is working well. And we mentioned earlier, it's sadly we even have to talk about domestic violence anymore, but at least now we can talk about it and have great services and great people doing amazing work. Thank you both so much for being here, and keep up the great work, and hope to see you again back on the show next time.
Our pleasure.
Thank you to Lieutenant Adam Hernandez with the Denver Police Department and Deputy DA Allison Rocker, and good luck at the new Rose Andom Center. We appreciate having you on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. We'll see you next time.